This morning I'd like to go to the first epistle of Paul to the church at Corinth to consider the comparison he makes in speaking to the church. We know that when Paul wrote to the church at Rome, he said all things that were written aforetime, and we take that to mean what we would consider the writings of the Old Testament, were written for our learning and for our understanding. That doesn't exclude what he wrote or what anyone else wrote in the letters to the churches or to individuals, because it is all connected. If we are to say that the, and I know this is a terrible phrase, the Pauline epistles are in any way, shape, or form separate from any other writing, we have to say there's inconsistency in the teaching of the Holy Spirit and in the gospel that these gentlemen were presenting. Now, if we're going to allow for the fact that the gospel is subject to interpretation and it is able to be changed by who's speaking and what the crowd is or what the audience is that's being spoken to, we might as well step right into the realms of the social gospel and tell everybody how it is adaptable to our society and interpretive to individuals. That is, of course, the logic of Adam. Because even today, especially today, and I know that that is a bit of an arrogant statement, but it probably applied to everybody in whatever generation there was, when they looked at the social attitudes and the social developments or degeneration, however they want to look at it, and say, this is the worst it's ever been. Well, the social gospel has come about, and I can't tell you when it came about, but I can tell you this. As soon as the concept of church and religion was equated with merchandise and business, then it became necessary to adapt the one to meet the needs of society. Now, unless we look back and say, oh, that happened here at the Great Awakening, that happened here at the Age of Enlightenment, remember that the scriptures tell us very plainly that the nation of Israel made merchandise of the glory of God. And Paul didn't just point that finger at the nation of Israel. They stood as a type. He said, when man, every son of Adam, knew God, he glorified him not as God, but became vain in his own imaginations, changing the glory of the Creator into the image of the creatures, and worshiped them rather than worship God. So this matter of a social gospel is nothing new. It has been from the beginning. As man has attempted to adapt the things of the scriptures, the things of the spirit, and make them plausible to the ways of man. But Paul comes and he says to the church here, he says, God has chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And you see right away now why it had to be fixed. Because how can God speak these things or have these things within his system that are not easily understandable, palatable to the individual, and gives the person a sense of being and involvement? How can you do these things? Why would you take the wise, the learned, the educated people of the world, and their collective writings and their collective reasonings, and use that as detrimental to the individual? That doesn't make any sense. You see, many years ago I said this, you know, Jesus on the mountain with the 5,000 and with the 7,000, and the disciples come to him and say, Lord, you don't know how to work the crowd here. See, that's what today's religion is. You got to get a crowd of people together and you have to work the crowd. You have to say something that appeals to the natural man. You have to do things that engage the natural man to give the people a sense of being, to give the people a sense of worth, and to make them a part of a group. But in the second chapter, Paul says, howbeit we speak wisdom amongst them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden, which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. He starts off with a statement to a congregation. He is not speaking in a public assembly of individuals that are just gathered together to hear somebody give a good speech. He's talking to a group of people that he personally knew. And he's talking to them as the apostle of Jesus Christ, not through the will of man, but through the will of God. Remember, Saul of Tarsus did not pick this occupation. The occupation that Saul of Tarsus wanted, that he strove for, was to be a Pharisee of Pharisees and to be the champion of the righteousness according to the law as they understood it. That was his course. He trained for it. He was educated for it. He was adapted to it. He was good at it. He profited above all of his kinsmen in it. And God said, that was your training. That was your education. That's what made you Saul of Tarsus. But I am the Lord whom you persecute. And it changed everything. Paul was not an apostle because he had found a matchbook cover that says, if you're out of work, try preaching. He was an apostle because Almighty God brought him to a point in his life, ordained of old, stopped him cold in his tracks, revealed unto him that the Lord God Almighty reigned within him, and that this is the course that he had for him. Now, I can say these words, and you can say these words, but can you describe them? Can you explain them? I can't explain them. How it is that the God of the universe, the Lord God Almighty, dwelt inside an individual. How is that possible? How is it possible that the supreme ruler of all things, the only one who inhabits eternity, could take on a bodily form in the fullness without any diminishing? You know, a lot of people with these doctrines that they have today talk about Jesus the Son in a subservient way, but being inferior to the Father. Jesus was the fullness of the Godhead in a bodily representation. Fullness, the absolute fullness. Now, we look out into the sky. Maybe I shouldn't make that an editorial comment. I look out into the sky, and I look up at the lights at night, and I cannot even imagine the extent of the universe or of the created system that God has made. And yet, he is above that. He is beyond that, and he is the creator and architect of all these things. Now, Paul says, we speak wisdom amongst them that are perfect. So you see how important it is that first things first, we become perfect. Then we'll understand what God has to say. Well, this perfection here is quite contrary to everything and anything that man possesses. We look at events in our lives and we say, this one went well, this one went bad, this one was profitable, this one was detrimental. And there's not a one of us who likes to go back and to say that from the beginning, not one person ever came into this world that was not dead in trespasses and sin. It's a horrible statement. But the fact is that the scripture tells us that in Adam, all have died. All have sinned. All have come short of the glory of God. And there's not one who is above the other. all are vile and corrupt. The standard of the social gospel is going to look down and say, well, wait a minute. Are you saying that the little child's lie is the same as the horrendous deeds of this individual who killed so many? Sin is not graded. There's not a weaker sin and a lesser sin and a greater sin and a more horrendous sin. Sin is the inability to hit the mark. It doesn't matter if I missed by a mile, I missed by an inch. It matters that it was not attained unto. Sin is the failure to measure up to the standard of the perfection of God. And everyone, every individual born under Adam does the works of his father. And since he failed, we fail. So this would exclude anyone who is of the seed of Adam. We speak wisdom amongst they who are perfect. The idea of perfect there is the idea of complete, full age, maturity. I would have liked to have thought that I was of complete age in my 20s. When I was full of all things and I knew all things and you asked me, I had all the answers. I know that because I was there. I remember. But as the Lord has brought me along, hopefully he has shown me, as one individual said many years ago, the older I get, the more I find out what I don't know and how much I don't know and how much I don't have any control over. So what is this perfection? Well, we know that there is, by the testimony of the Scriptures, an incorruptible seed, born of God, born from above, that cannot sin, because the seed of God remains in them. So, what Paul is attempting to speak here to the church at Corinth is not something that he's saying you need to get your social attitudes correct. You need to get your activities correct. You need to straighten up and fly right. Grab your bootstraps and pull them up. That's not what he's saying, because that wisdom is the applicable wisdom to this flesh who may reason, I need to straighten things out. I need to correct things. And correct whatever you like. I love the people that say, I'm going to turn over a new leaf. Well, excuse me, but if you turn over a new leaf, it's the same leaf that's been rotting, laying on the ground, and it's not going to make anything better. It's the same leaf. You just flip-flopping back and forth like some dead fish on the floor. Paul is not talking to the church at Corinth and saying, you people need to get things straightened out. He does bring up a very major point in the beginning. He says, wait a minute. It's reported that there's divisions amongst you. Divisions. One says I'm of Paul. One says I'm of Apollos. One says I'm of Cephas. And the rest of you are nice and holy. And you say, well, we are of Jesus. And he makes a very good question. Who made you different? And what is there in your being that you have that has not been given to you of God? The Spirit of God has given every one of his children all things necessary for life and godliness. There's not one thing lacking. Now, we go to Adam, and we've made this mention so many times. We go back to the garden, and we see the attitude of Adam, both in Eve and in Adam, and we see the fact that they are dissatisfied with the station in life that God has given them. Therefore, Eve looked upon the fruit, saw that it was good for meat. What meat was she lacking? What food was she lacking? Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. It's like somebody going to a buffet table and complaining because their favorite food wasn't there. There it is. It's all there. You may have whatever you want. She saw that the fruit was good to eat and that it was one to be greatly desired to make one wise. Was there someone there who had told her how foolish she was? Had she taken the state aptitude test and failed miserably? Had she fallen in the charts of our education system to show how low and substandard this individual was? What made her think that she was not wise except for the nature that God had given her and given her in Adam to desire something better? Paul says, wait a minute, people. You think you're holy and righteous because you say you're of Paul? Well, guess what? I'm the chiefest of sinners. So is that the standard you're telling me? You want to tell me how you are of Apollos? Wait a minute. He was instrumental in such a division amongst us that he and I split ways. Well, we have factions now because he took Mark and went out and I took Silas. Are there factions? Or are we losing sight of the important thing, which is the gospel? You want to say you're of Peter? Do we need to remind anybody what Peter did? And this is not something that we can look and point fingers at. These were things that identify the individuals. Those things which we look back on any of the individuals that are mentioned in the scriptures and we can say, oh, I want to be like, and you can fill in the blank. Rest assured, there's sufficient there to show you that in Adam, they were not a role model. They were not somebody who wanted to be followed after. Oh, I want to be like David. What? When he's standing in front of Amalek with the spittle running down his beard, acting like a crazy man? Is that what you want to be? You want to be the one that goes out and murders somebody just so he can have an affair with his wife? Is that the man we want to be? And when it comes to Adam, we are all sinful and unclean. And there is nothing good within us. Oh, this is a great individual. I want to be like. Fill it in. How many individuals do you know of would want to raise their hand and say, you know what? I want to be like the thief of the cross. You want to make sure you get your fill of life before you make that conversion. Wouldn't want to be like Samuel. That kid was roped in from the beginning. He didn't have any fun in his life. Oh, I want to be like Samson. Yeah. You know, I get to do everything. I get to maraud and I get to philander and do everything I want and then die when he pushes the temple down. How many of us would want to say, prior to a certain time, that they wouldn't mind have been Judas? To walk with the Lord, to hear Him teach, to sit at His feet, to go out and do the mighty works that He did, to come back with the 70 rejoicing, saying, even Satan is subject to your name. And conversely, how many of us would want to have said, we want to be like Saul of Tarsus, wielding that power? You see, we have a perception that is not true to the truth. We have the perception of man. Howbeit, we speak wisdom amongst them that are perfect. The wisdom of God is the hidden things. Wisdom encompasses all the things of God, everything that there could possibly be about God. Now, wisdom, of course, we speak of it in an abstract manner. And we say wisdom is the application of understanding and the ability to live by standards. But the Proverbs tell us that wisdom is much more personal. Doth not wisdom cry and understanding put forth her voice? Well, I know that's an editorial comment there. That's the way we have personalized the concept of wisdom. Really? I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, wherever the earth was. Now, we just made the comment that the prophet tells us there's only one who inhabits eternity, and that's the Lord God Omnipotent, who has from the beginning in and of Himself reigned supreme over all things. There's none that He asks counsel of. There's none who has opposed Him in anything that He's done. And yet here we have an individual representation. I was set up from everlasting, Proverbs chapter 8. When there were no depths, I brought forth. When there were no foundations abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills, was I brought forth. Wisdom says, in the beginning, I was with God. Part of God. And it makes the statement in a very personal manner. You see, we look at wisdom and knowledge and understanding, and we take the young ones and we say, they need to go and they need to be educated and they need to learn these things. And when they learn the facts and begin to apply the reasoning here, they become wiser and wiser and wiser. Paul said, I'm not speaking to people who have gotten wiser. I'm speaking the wisdom of God, which man cannot understand, to those who are perfect. Those who are perfect, born of an incorruptible spirit, born from above, born of God, not of the will of man. Now, of course, we could break into a long litany here of diatribes and aspersions against the educational systems of this world and the degrees that are given out, but remember something. The man who wrote this was trained in those systems. He was brought through those systems. He was educated so that he could stand as an authority on those systems and say they're worthless. Every one of us has had a past and a background and a history that has brought us through so many things. And we look back and we could say, I wish that had never happened. I don't know about you. I'll say it. I wish that had never happened. I wish I could have changed that. I wish this hadn't happened. I wish this had happened. But it is only by the teaching of the Spirit, of the wisdom of God, who teaches each and every one of His children, my way is not your way. We speak wisdom amongst those who are perfect. We speak the wisdom of God hidden, a mystery, concealed, purposely made so that one cannot see it. The hidden mysteries of God are not a Sudoku puzzle or a crossword puzzle that we can sit down and start working on all the clues to try and figure it out. Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. Now, if that is not in the heart of man, if that is not something that comes by observation, if that is not something that can be reasoned out through some great dissertation, then we can say it absolutely has no application whatsoever to the heart of man, the mind of man, the reasoning of man, or the speech of man. Paul said, I saw these things. I was lifted up, and I can tell you, we don't have the ability. Not only do we not have the ability to explain it, but we don't have the ability to understand it. We speak the wisdom amongst them that are perfect, not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. It is interesting, it is interesting that the Greek word here for princes does not necessarily mean the second in command. You know, you have the king and then you have the prince. Not talking about the second in command of the world. The word is transliterated into the English as architect. The architects of this world. The builders, the shapers, the movers, the important people. The ones that play out the important parts that God has selected and assigned. And you know what? They don't know what they're doing. No one knows what they're doing. I've got a great plan. I've got a great agenda. And you know what? Saul of Tarsus had a good one too, didn't he? But God has said, I draw my people along with the cords of men. And they don't know it. I give them the things that are necessary for them, and they are unaware of it. I have made you who you are for a specific purpose, and you don't know the purpose. I have set you on a path to walk and given you the strength to walk it, and you have no idea where you're going. This one thing we all know. We came forth out of the grave, out of the womb, and we are headed for the grave. That much we know. But He has made our path crooked. He has hedged in the sides with hewn stone. We cannot see what's around the corner. We cannot straighten it out. We walk one step at a time, even though we don't esteem it that way. The princes of this world do not understand, cannot understand, the wisdom of God. We speak the wisdom of God hidden in a mystery. Once again, we go to Matthew chapter 13. The disciples turn to the Lord and say, why are you speaking in parables, man? You got an audience here. You know, you're supposed to be whipping them up and getting them ready to go and storm the castle, and we're supposed to take over and set up the earthly kingdom. What's going on here? And he says, I speak in parables because it is not given unto them to know. It's given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom, but it is not given unto them to know. Oh, that's so arrogant. Oh, that makes you right and everybody else wrong. Well, if we take what the theology of Adam has decreed and propagated as being the gospel and apply it to that setting, yes, it is. It's very arrogant. I mean, after all, what makes you right and everybody else wrong? But if we take the truth of the gospel as the Spirit teaches, because it is the Spirit that communicates comparing spiritual things with spiritual things, we then get an understanding that it is not a point of arrogance that the wisdom of God is proclaimed to them that are perfect, because what is being proclaimed is the power of God over absolutely all things. For who he foreknew, them also he predestinated. You see, the natural man looks at that and says, oh, that's so unfair. That's why there's so much objection to the concept of predestination. That's so unfair. But let's consider. And believe me, I'm not trying to unveil the mystery, because I can't unveil the mystery, because I don't know why God did it this way. I don't know why it was necessary for him to do it this way. And I have no idea what the chemistry is or what the facts are as to how these things work together. But I can tell you this. Whom he foreknew, whom God had a personal experience with, those that he foreknew, before what? Before anything. Didn't we just say God was the only one that inhabited eternity? That's right. And when God created man, he created him in his image. Male and female created he them, and he created them having his seed in him. Now, if that's the image that we see in man in the type, what is the reality of God? He has his seed in him. He has his bride in him. He is complete. Nothing can be added to him. Nothing can be taken away from him. So in the beginning, before anything was created, God knew his people. And these that he foreknew, them also did he predestinate. Predestinate? The pre-establishment of a destination? How can that possibly be? There's no time in eternity. How could it possibly be that something that has no bearing upon time, God would set a destination? Doesn't the idea of a destination mean a beginning point and an ending point and all things in between? Yes, it does. And he predestinated those whom he foreknew, for whom he had his eternal love. Yea, I have loved you with an eternal love, to go through things, to experience things, to be transformed, to be made after the image of the Son. Well, wait a minute. Christmas hadn't come yet. Jesus hadn't been born yet. That's right. It's before. And before the children having not yet been born, neither having done good nor evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, before this, before he uttered the words in the beginning, let there be light, before this, God had a people. He had the purpose, the power, the intention, and the fulfillment that he would fashion from a lump of clay a vessel for this people, that they would endure, becoming partakers of flesh and blood, endure the vanity of this world, the experience of this life, that they would know what the contradiction of sin was against themselves, that they should conform to the image of the Son, who, before the foundation of the world, stood as the Lamb slain. Oh yes, we see that wonderful Lamb slain. Think about it. That Lamb slain had to experience the contradiction of sin. He had to have the imputed sin of his people upon him. He had to have the travail of the soul. He had to experience all these things so that he could stand resurrected, being the acceptable sacrifice for sin. He had to have all of this in him experienced before anything took place. Because God is not swayed by the actions of his creation. He is not a respecter of persons. He does not react to anything. He did not create heaven and earth, sit back with a lever here for plan A and a lever here for plan B, wanting to see what Adam would do. Adam was created capable of sinning, incapable of hitting the mark of excellence. He was created capable of being corrupted, therefore he was corrupted. He acted exactly the way God had ordained, prepared, and predestined that he would walk, and he did it by the will of God, who brings all things to pass by his perfect will. Now, this is a mystery. This is a mystery that I don't understand completely, and I know you don't understand it completely, and anybody who does say that they understand it completely is telling me that they have the mind of God, which they don't. But I can tell you this, the mystery is concealed from the architects of this world. It is concealed and it is hidden. They look at it, and the wise master builders of this world have rejected it. It has no place. It doesn't fit. It's not of the right composition. There is no place for it in this world. But to the children of grace, whom the Spirit has compared spiritual things with spiritual things, and has shown us the vileness of our ways, the uncleanness of our ways, we sure are thankful that that blood was still, that it wasn't waiting around for me to accept it, wasn't waiting around for me to give the high sign of acknowledgement, to put in my bid to win the lot. It was done before. Before. He had to have a vessel prepared so that it would not tarnish the incorruptible seed. You cannot have the two. They do not exist. You cannot have a body corrupted and polluted because it is dead in trespasses and sin, coming in contact with an incorruptible seed. The two opposite forces do not meet. They cannot be together. Therefore, he took the vessel. He cleansed it with the blood so that it would not pollute the incorruptible seed. And he planted his children in each and their time, in the vessel before prepared, that we might experience those things that he has talked about here. For none of the princes of this world, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Now, how many of you have heard this? I've heard this so many times. Satan entered into Judas, and that's what started everything. Satan was sitting there with all of his armies. He was just waiting for that moment to rush in and to destroy the Messiah, bring him down, and therefore Satan could set up his kingdom. Let me ask you something. Did Satan know who he was? Did he know who this man Jesus was? He certainly did. He came to him and tempted him and said, "If you be the Son of God." 3 times he opposed him. How many of his demons, and we don't know how many there are, and I'm not going to get into a study of devils, demons, imps, or whatever. Did they know who he was? They cried out, the evil spirit cried out, "I know who you are. You are the Christ. Have you come to torment us?" And he forbade them to speak. He didn't need their testimony. What about after he left this earth? Man went about in the name of Christ trying to cast out demons. And the demon said to him, "I know Jesus. I know Paul. I don't know you." So do we have a situation here where Satan didn't know what was going to happen? That he was going forth with this attempt to kill the King of Glory, not knowing what possibly could have happened? Not in the least bit. The obedient servant of Almighty God stirred the hearts and minds of these people in darkness, and their hearts were made fat lest they see or lest they perceive. Their ears were made heavy, their eyes were kept blind, because it had to happen. There had to be the manifestation. Remember, there were two walking on the road to Emmaus. Their hearts were heavy because of what had happened. Jesus came up and started talking with them and wondering. He said, what has happened? They said, are you from afar? You don't know what has happened? And he opened the scriptures to them. How that the Christ must needs suffer and die. The manifestation had to be made of the eternal truth of that shed blood, the perfect sacrifice for sin. He had to do it. Therefore, the princes of this world were kept in ignorance. It was not revealed unto them, because the natural man cannot know these things, neither can he receive the things of the Spirit. They were prevented by the hand of God. When we read back here, it says, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. And in the translation it says, even the hidden wisdom. I think a better understanding of this is we preach the mystery of the wisdom of God concealed. Purposely concealed. Not accidentally. He didn't go out and hide it someplace and say to all of his children, now you go out on an Easter egg hunt here and see if you can find it. The wisdom, the hidden wisdom of God is concealed, lest they should see it, lest they should hear it, lest they should understand it. And Jesus says, and I have to heal them. Well, wait a minute. Isn't that the whole idea? Get people healed, get people saved, get people into the kingdom? Why wouldn't Jesus say, here, open that eyes right there. Open this one over here. I want them to hear. I want them to see so that they can, you know, come to me and then they can be healed. And he stands back and says, okay, your eyes are open now. All you have to do is come to me and I'll heal you. That's neo-evangelical ideologies. The blood was spilled. The blood was shed in measure. By this shall all the iniquity of Jacob be purged. There remains, therefore, no more blood. There's nobody who can come in off the street and grab a ticket and say, I'm next at the counter, I need to have some of that blood so I can be healed. Jesus said, make the heart of the people fat. Make their eyes dull, make their eyes blind, make their hearing dull, lest they should hear and be converted, and I have to heal them. There's no more blood. How would he do it? There remains no more blood. Lest they should hear and be converted. So then, does faith come by hearing and hearing by the word of God? Absolutely it does. Because where the word of the king is, there is power. And where there is power, there is belief. And that's what he comes to his children with. It's not like the theologian says that when he comes and works his work in your heart, that it's your responsibility to come to him. Where there the word of the king is, there is power that causes you to move. It causes you to go. It brings you, as the one prophet said, he said, the Spirit of the Lord came upon me, grabbed me by the hair on the back of my neck, and took me where I needed to go. And that is what the power of God is. That's the mystery of God. Can I say to you, I understand it? I don't think I can. But I can tell you this. That's the gospel. That it is the power of God unto salvation. But God has revealed, we just said it, The princes of this world, the architects of this world, didn't know these things. For had they known these things, they would never crucify Christ. They would have said, we're going to thwart the whole plan of salvation. You know, how many times have you heard this? Man thought he was going to stop God's plan by crucifying Christ. No. If they had known that he was Messiah, they would not have crucified him, thus thwarting the plan of God. But God has revealed unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Don't think you're going to find it in the book. Don't think you're going to find it in the sermon. Don't think you're going to find it in sitting down and having a conversation with somebody. God has revealed the mystery. Now, the nations of this world like to say, well, the mystery is that the Gentiles should be partakers of the same promise as the Jews. Yes, that is a mystery. But there's also the part of the mystery is this. What is the promise? The promise is where you look and you say, there are the people of God. That's an outward show. That's a facade. When you look and you say, well, there ain't no people of the Lord there. There indeed is the people of the Lord. They are the people of the covenant because they are despised and rejected of all men. God has revealed unto us by His Spirit. If you have not the Spirit, you're none of His. I can't give you the Spirit. I can't tell you what to do to go out and procure the Spirit. And I can't tell you what incantation or prayer to pray to get the Spirit. If you are born of the Spirit, you are of the Spirit. If you are of the Spirit, you are a child of grace. If you are a child of grace, the blessings and the promises abide within you. And God has revealed unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, the deep things of God. He's not separate from God. He's not the third person of the divine essence. He is the breath of God, and once you separate the breath of man from man, He no longer exists. How do you separate the breath of God from the fullness of God? For what man knows the things of man save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of this world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. If I'm going to tell you how to get your life on track, if I'm going to tell you how to get your finances in order, if I'm going to tell you how to clean up this and change this and correct this, then I'm telling you the spirit of man, the wisdom of this world. In the garden, Adam's eyes were open. He reasoned in his logic how to fix it. And he failed miserably because he didn't know what it was. He didn't know what the problem was. And he didn't know how to fix it. So if you hear an individual who wants to get up and tell you the things that you need to do to straighten things out and to get your life on the straight and narrow, that's the wisdom of the world. You want to hear somebody get up and tell you that in you, that is in your flesh, dwells no good thing, that you are alienated from God and the commonwealth of the Israel of our God, that you are without hope in this world? There's the mystery of God, because I can't tell you how to fix it. And I can't tell you that I fixed it. I have a hope. I have a hope that it has been fixed for me. I have a hope that by the grace of God it has been applied. I have a hope that from the beginning, this mystery is a reality to me. But the natural man, which things we also speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches. You see the import of that coming from a man like Paul, Saul of Tarsus, Paul. He had all the wisdom. Well, you ask him something in some foreign language, he could probably quote it to you and define it for you and tell you the jots and tittles and even tell you the ancient Hebrew text, as some would brag that they speak. This was a wise man. This was an educated man. Wise according to the things of this world. And he said, you know what? All of that learning was worthless. It was essential in God's decree that this is how this individual should be made. But think about it. He was in the flesh, educated in all of these ways, profitable in all these ways, excelled in all these ways. People looked up to him. He was the grand poobah. Everybody wanted to be like him. And he said, you know what? I'm not talking to you after that former way of life. The Lord gave me all these things so that to the barbarian, I'm a barbarian. To the Greek, I'm a Greek. To the Jew, I'm a Jew, and I can speak these ways, but that is unprofitable, and my lesson, my education is, that is of the world worthless. Not, it won't do you a bit of good. Not one bit of good. Because the natural man does not receive the things, the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness. Now, the word foolish there means without strength. In other words, they can't work. Somebody comes down the aisle and says to an individual, you need to get on your knees and accept Jesus. And they fall to their knees and they try it. Even with weeping. Only to find out it didn't work. Because it didn't have any strength to it. It was worthless. Someone finds themselves in the solitude of their mind and their heart, grieving over the fact that they are a sinner without hope. They need mercy. The natural man looks at that and says, that's got no strength. What's that going to do for you? That's not going to fix anything. The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit because to him they have no strength. Neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual, he that is born of the Spirit, he that has the Spirit of God within, judges all things, yet he himself is judge of no man. Now that doesn't mean that he's high and mighty and pious and good, because he's judged himself. And he knows, as the apostle says, that when I would be good, evil is present. He cries out, O wretched man that I am. And he understands that in me that is in this flesh dwells no good things. For who has known the mind of God, the Lord, that he might instruct the one who is born? It's the Spirit. The new covenant, we go back to it so very many times, and I'll close here. The new covenant tells us, I will give you a new heart, and I will remove the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh, a heart of feeling, a heart of understanding, a heart of passion. And I will put my Spirit within you, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Every child of grace has it. He will cause you to walk according to my statutes. You will keep my commandments. And you will know the uncleanness of your ways. And you will despise yourself and you will hate yourself. And you will know that salvation is of the Lord. We speak the wisdom of God hidden, a mystery. The world looks at it, and I'm not talking about pointing a finger outside. The world is right here in Adam. Adam looks at it and says, that doesn't work. I need to do something with my hands. But the instruction of the Lord to each time to his children as we go back in the type of the nation of Israel, stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. Jonah, salvation is of the Lord. It is his doing, it is his business. Pray the Lord will give us understanding and peace in this matter. Let's pray. Father, we do acknowledge that the beauty and the wonder of your word and your promises far escapes our rationale and our understanding. And yet we time and time again would like to have a little glimpse, a little morsel, that we might have hope in the flesh. We thank you that the flesh cannot glory in your sight. We thank you that you have decreed all things finished in you from the beginning, that it's not left up to us, for in the flesh we are miserably lost. We acknowledge before you that we complain, that we are not satisfied with what you have given to us, that we seek to improve the flesh, though the outer man is perishing. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you that you have shown to us the wretchedness of our ways. We pray, Lord, that you continue to show your love upon your people as your chastening hand directs them and shows them the vanity of this world. We thank you for our time together, Lord. We pray that it is your Spirit that teaches, not the wisdom of man. It's in your name we pray. Amen.